I think this is the right time for me to say that please switch off your mobiles. It's a great pleasure and privilege to have Dr. Rosie Llewellyn-Jones MBE as our esteemed guest today. And we are very grateful to Mr. Waqar Khan, the founder of Bangladesh Forum for Heritage Studies, for making possible for us to invite her here to BRAC University. He has helped us tremendously in organizing this program. We are very grateful to you, sir. Dr. Llewellyn-Jones's presentation is based on her book, A Fatal Friendship, The Nawabs, The British, and The City of Lucknow. And we are really honored to have you with us here today, madam. And we accord you a very cordial welcome. Zahe Naseeb and Khush Amdeed. I'll now request the chairperson of the Department of English and Humanities, Professor Firdaus Azim, to bring our guest to the stage and accord her the best of very cordial welcomes.
Everybody, and I hope we have a very, interesting and important lecture today. Dr. Rosie Llewellyn-Jones is, as we've just heard, an acclaimed historian and author who specializes in the history of colonial India. Her work on Lucknow has been so intense and so wide-ranging, I think, even I, as a non-historian, has read her book, The Last King of India, and so that she's been given the honorary title of a Lucknowite. She herself, she's written many prolifically on Lucknow, and her books include The Lucknow Omnibus, Lucknow, A City of Illusions, Lucknow Then and Now, Engaging Scoundrels, True Tales of Old Lucknow, as well as The Last King of India, Wajid Ali Shah. Her books on Lucknow have given her the status of a Lucknowite. She herself is a scholar of Urdu and Persian, of Urdu and Hindi, in which she had graduated with a first class, and she went on to do her PhD at SOAS at the University of London on the colonial architecture in India, if I'm not mistaken. She is the only historian to have been acknowledged as a member of the Order of the British Empire, or MBE. This is, for her, this has been an ironic distinction, because she has said, regarding this rare distinction, she has commented on the irony of being given the accolade despite having spent much of her academic career criticizing the British Empire. So with these few words, I invite Rosie, as she is known fondly by everyone, to come and deliver her lecture for today. So happy to see you. I'll sit so that I can see.
Thank you very much indeed for that warm welcome. I also thank the university for hosting this event. I thank the Vice Chancellor. I thank Mr. Waqar Khan, who has made my visit possible despite last minute anxieties. And I'm delighted to find a fellow alumni from SOAS sitting in the front row. So I feel at home. People sometimes ask me how I got so involved with Lucknow. And the answer is that during my first degree at SOAS, one of the books we had to read, a set book, was Geschichte Lucknow by Mulana Sharir. And at the time, it seemed pretty tough going. I had a little Hindi, but I had to learn the Urdu script. And this was a very, very long book, but we ploughed through it. And in the end, Sharir made Lucknow seem like a place which was certainly worth a week's visit. So in 1972, when I actually had 9 months in India, and this was part of the language course, I went there. And in a way, I've never left it. What I found then, and we're looking at a long, long time ago, without the internet, without many of the facilities that we have today, was a haunting and fascinating city. And what particularly interested me were buildings which were clearly of European origin, of European architecture. And no one I met could tell me what they were. I would point to a spectacular building which was quite clearly based on the European classical mode. And I'd say, what's that? And they would say, ye Baramkhan hai. Yes, uske kya naam hai? Baramkhan hai. And that's as far as we got. It was either a big building, or it was a small building, or it was an old building. There were lots of Purana Makans. And this didn't really satisfy me. So when I got back to London, to university, I started to look for the definitive guide to Lucknow. And all I could find were old guidebooks. Probably the most recent was the 1930s. There was nothing there. I was disappointed. I really needed to find out what these buildings were and who had built them. So since I couldn't find anything, I decided to write my own book. And this was my PhD subject. And it was published in 1985. By an Indian publisher. And the title came from a very, very brief anonymous pamphlet, which was written just after 1857, after the annexation of Awadh, or Oud, as the Victorians knew it. And it described how the relationship between the Nawabs and the British residents, who were representing the East India Company, was in fact a fatal friendship. It was fatal to the Nawabs, who later became kings. And I thought this was such a good title. It encapsulates the relationship between the two. My publishers were a little bit wary about it, but nevertheless, this is what we went for. So this is how the title arose. And it is the relationship between the British and the Nawabs and their nobles that continues to fascinate me, so much so that my most recent book has been on Wajid Ali Shah, the last king in India. I'm not going to concentrate too much on him, but I think what I want to do is to explain how this relationship came about. This is the coat of arms of the East India Company, and it's stands at present in the old India Office Library, in the British Library, in London. And I think most Indian historians still resent the fact that we're not allowed to call it the India Office Library any longer. But it is full of records of the East India Company, and these were moved from the British Museum about 15 years ago. And at first we thought we were going to have a dedicated room, which we called the India Office Library, but not so, apparently. But nevertheless, whenever you go in there and whenever you sit down and order manuscripts, this is what you see when you look up at the wall. And the Latin tag underneath says, by the command of the English Parliament and the King. And I think it's significant that it is the English Parliament, and it is the English East India Company. It's not British, it is English. Though obviously there are a lot of people from Scotland, the preponderance of people from Scotland in the company. Some Welsh and many Irish who came as soldiers, but we know it as the East India Company. And it is really this that led to the beginning of that fatal friendship. By the 1720s, the Mughal Empire was breaking down. It had started to crumble from the death of Aurangzeb in 1707. And within a space of about 4 years, we get three satellite states, as I would describe them. We get Murshidabad in Bengal. Murshid Kuli Khan breaks away. We also get Bahanul Mulk in Awadh breaking away. We get Asaf Jah in Hyderabad. And it's interesting that all three men came from outside the states that they were finally to make their own. And I think the reason for this is something to do with an immigrant. Immigrants come in with a lot of energy, and because they don't bring their roots with them, they're moving to somewhere new, they have to build their own power bases. And this is what happened. All of these three states became very, very powerful. As I say, they broke away from the disintegrating circle of the Mughal Empire. So if you can imagine, they were satellite states, in a way, forming another circle. And all three men had originally been appointed as governors, Nawabs, if you like, to the Mughal Emperor. And they all became, in a way, hereditary rulers. There was a line of succession that passed down. This, of course, wouldn't have happened 100 years earlier, because the idea was that you shifted people before they got too comfortable. But these men became very comfortable indeed. This is a painting by what we call a native artist. It means a non-European artist. And it shows Shujur Dola and his sons. And it's an interesting painting because we don't have the original, but in the corner, the unknown artist has painted, the European artist who was painting Shujur Dola and his family. And that rather strange figure who's always intrigued me in the left-hand corner is Tilly Kettle. And Tilly Kettle was the first European artist to come to India to start to exploit the vanity, if you like, of some of the rulers, but also to explore the exotic. And had Tilly Kettle not been successful, then we simply wouldn't have any of the company paintings that we do today. He blazed the trail. He started off in Madras, not finding very much work there. He moved up to Awadh, and at this time, the court of Awadh, the capital, was actually in Faisabad, which is about 90 miles to the east of Lucknow. So Tilly Kettle comes in, he's painting here, and he always, in some weird kind of way, is quite a contemporary figure. He looks like the kind of guy you'd see hunched over a computer today, a real computer geek, with his sort of bottled glasses and his sideburns and his intense air. So the interest in this is that the tall figure in the center is obviously Shujur Dola, and to his side stands Asaf Dola, who is going to become the next Nawab. And further on, the taller person in the dark blue jacket is Sadat Ali Khan, and they were two brothers. Shujur Dola badly misjudged the situation, and he formed an unholy alliance with the emperor and with Mir Qasim of Murshidabad, and they tried to take on the East India Company, and they were roundly defeated at Buxar in 1764. And it was really from this that the trouble started, because the East India Company, always a punitive company, and especially when it had managed to defeat Indian rulers, decided to levy an enormous fine on Awadh. And it also said it was going to station troops in and around Lucknow to act as a defense, if you like, for the Nawabs. So in a way, you can see it as perhaps security, a protection racket. the English say, we will look after you, there will be no more invasions of your territory, we will station some of our troops here, but you have to pay for them. And you also have to pay us a huge amount of money because we beat you at Buxa. It sounds simplistic, but this is actually how the company worked. And this was the start of that huge financial dependency that the Nawabs had on the East India Company. People have written about the treaties and the enormous loans that the Nawabs were able to make to the East India Company. And it's actually quite surprising and shocking. Had it not been from money given by the Nawabs, then the British could not have brought their troops back after the first Afghan war. Huge sums of money. It also paid for the first Anglo-Burmese war. The Nawabs, you must realize, were extraordinarily rich men, and most of this came from land revenue. Awadh was an extremely fertile area. It was a huge area. It shrank in size after 1801, but it actually took up an enormous area, and it encompassed Allahabad. And this is mainly where their money came from. Some of it came from customs duties, from river tolls. You couldn't cross a river unless you obviously paid taxes. But basically, it was land revenue. And the English, of course, always hard up, always perennially hard up, thought, oh, we have something useful here. And also, geographically, Awadh took up a place. If you look at the British invasion, incursions into the Indian subcontinent, and they're ploughing up through Bengal, Bihar, and Orissa, Awadh actually sticks out like an annoying sore thumb. And Dalhousie, who was later to order the annexation, actually wanted to complete the picture. He wanted to have an unbroken band of company rule right from Calcutta right up to Delhi, and Awadh was actually the last plum in his plan. This is Asafa Dola, and this is based on a painting by Johann Zoffany, who was another artist following in Tilly Kettle's footsteps. It's a very, very good likeness. And here he is. Asafa Dola is known for many things. He's first of all known for his size. He was actually an extremely plump man. There's no getting around it. And even by his mid-20s, he was actually too fat to sit on an elephant. They couldn't physically haul him up. And another thing that people know about Asafa Dola and Lucknow are kebabs. It's famous for its kebabs. And the reason is it took me quite a long time to work out why. We know that the Nawab was very fond of kebabs. But I found a description of him to say that as a young man, as he got fatter and fatter, he'd actually lost all of his teeth, and therefore he couldn't chew meat. And this is why the kebabs had to be so finely minced. And I was very pleased when I found that out, because it shows that there's always a glimmer of truth behind most of these stories, and that was quite gratifying. He was a vain man. He was a drunkard. There are descriptions of him and his enormous hunting parties, which would take 3 months or so, getting drunk with some of the British officers, getting drunk like beasts, as somebody described it. So he's very, very fond of his food and drink. He was also, at the same time, an imaginative man, and I think it's quite fair to say that he was able to stamp his authority on Lucknow initially. He had been at the court of Faizabad, but he decided to move the capital to Lucknow. And it is said this is because he wanted to escape his mother's influence. And it is an extremely brave Indian man who tries to escape his mother's influence. This was probably the bravest decision of his life. So he moves to Lucknow, which is not a negligible village. It's actually a medieval town of some size. And its chief building is the Machivaman Fort, which stands on the banks of the river Gupti.
There's also a stone bridge, a so-called stone bridge, which is actually brick and stucco, and this seems to have predated Asaph's arrival. People do claim that he himself built it. I can't find any evidence of that. I think it was there before. So if you can imagine a fort on one of Lucknow's three small hills next to the river with a bridge going over it, and the chalk, the market area, which is now part of old Lucknow. And one thing we do know about the chalk is it was very, very dirty. There's no doubt about that. Everyone complains of how dirty it was. And it actually formed a kind of a valley with little streams running off it, running down it. So, of course, all the sewage and effluent comes in. But it's still a fascinating place, and it's very interesting to walk along the chalk. It's bounded on one side by the Akbari Darwaza. So we know that Akbar was there, and he built this gate across at the end of the chalk. We also have the Asafi Mosque, but I think he is probably best known for the enormous imambara, the Bara imambara, as we call it. And this was a huge complex, which was finished about 1784. And the story is that it was a famine relief measure. There was famine in the land at the time. There was not enough work. There was not enough money for people. So it is said he set this up as a gigantic aid program, if you like. Whether this is true or not, we don't know. But I think he will always be noticeable for this, the Bara Imambara. And to one side stands the Jama Masjid. And interestingly, there's a Bauli to the other side, to the left-hand side, which we believe may actually predate Asaph's arrival. Certainly Warren Hastings was put up there when he arrived, and he was put up in one of the rooms in the Bauli, and he thought it was very, very splendid and very cool because of the water fountain coming up. So there's a lot that we can actually thank Asaph Adola for. Certainly the townspeople loved him, and they said, you know, whoever hasn't got money, Asaph Adola will give it him. So he is seen as a liberal ruler, a Shia ruler, building one of the biggest imambaras in India, only to be superseded by the imambara of Murshidabad. A religious man, a pious man, who can also at the same time get drunk with his officers, and possibly a homosexual, because he does not, despite his number of wives, he doesn't seem to have had an heir. There was a putative heir called Wazir Ali, who was quickly deposed by the East India Company, but we're not sure about his antecedent. So the line of succession then passed to his brother, Sadat Ali Khan, who was considered actually a very, very good ruler indeed. But I'm fond of Asaph. He has a lot of good qualities. He was very, very gullible. It is said that anybody could sell him anything if it came from the West. He was extremely fond of trinkets, all kinds of things. And what he and his successors particularly loved were clockwork mechanisms. If you sold him a cuckoo clock, he was absolutely delighted. He would pay a fortune for it. He liked the mechanisms. So watches, cuckoo clocks, anything that moved. He set up a little museum himself, and it was ridiculed by Europeans who saw it, to say it looks like the cheapest kind of bazaar, because what we find is a very, very good painting, perhaps a painting by Zoffany of the Nawab himself, and it's next to a cheap cuckoo clock. So it's a real hodgepodge, and I must say, having gone round some of Dhaka's antique shops today, I could visualize it now. I couldn't before, but I had great fun this morning going to some of the shops. Can we get this back to full screen? I've obviously pressed the wrong button. I want you to see this full screen. That's fine, thank you very much. This is Warren Hastings. It's probably the best portrait we've got of him, the Governor General of India, appointed by the East India Company. here he is as a young man, and this portrait I think may also be by Tilly Kettle. But the reason I put it in is not to go on about painters too much, but he was the adversary of Asafoetida. And he visits Lucknow in the 1780s, and he describes it in withering tones. Always, he's put up in a very nice place in the valley, but he says it was the most awful nest of corruption and infidelity and young boys doing naughty things, and he is absolutely scathing about it. And after that, the company begin to put the screws on Asafoetida and subsequent Nawabs. When Asaf moved his capital to Lucknow, he brought with him a British resident who had been appointed to the court of Faisalabad about 1773, a man called Nathaniel Middleton, who was to crop up several more times. So you've already got this relationship, and once Asaf moves to Lucknow, the British resident moves with him, and he demands that he should have his own accommodation. And this became so exaggerated that it's fair to say there were almost two courts at one point, the court of the Nawabs and the court of the East India Company. Warren Hastings, as you probably know, was subsequently impeached. Perhaps we can have questions later, yeah? Can we have questions later, please? Okay. Warren Hastings, as you know, was impeached. He'd made an enemy of Edmund Burke, and it's interesting that the reason Edmund Burke was so passionate about impeaching Hastings was that Burke had lost an awful lot of money in East India Company shares. He'd invested unwisely, so it was actually a financial motive, which I thought was quite interesting. After 7 long years, it was decided that Hastings didn't really have to answer any charges, but he was a broken man. And some of the impeachment charges were Hastings' supposed behavior towards Asafoetida's begums, if you like. The begums of other became a talking point. It was said that Hastings took money from them under false pretenses. And of course, the argument was that the begums had given him the money voluntarily. People have written so many books about this, I'm not going to go into it, but you see the conflict between Hastings representing the East India Company and Asaf representing himself. Now, this is not to say that Europeans didn't enjoy a very, very good lifestyle at the court of Ovid. There's no doubt about it. And I think one thing that interests me almost more than the company officials, who are, you know, they're fairly uptight and they're always responsible to the Governor General in Calcutta, and in turn they're responsible to the Court of Directors in London. It is a trading company, that's how it started off. And officials, even the Governor General, are always very aware of the need to make profits for the shareholders. But at the same time, you start to get what we call freelancers coming into Ovid, because they too are attracted by the riches of the state. They know there is money to be made, and some of them are quite prepared to make money by selling ridiculous things to the Nawabs. And people come in quite boldly and said, you know, I have been told that I can make a fortune of £10,000 within 3 months if I do the right things, if I bring the right things for the Nawabs. And they exploited them ridiculously, not only the Nawabs, but their ministers too. But out of this came some great paintings and some great stories. This is one of two versions, and it's painted by Johann Zoffany. One version was done for Warren Hastings, who was not averse to having lovely paintings showing the decadent court of Lucknow. And this one is actually in the Tate Gallery in London, and it is full of interest. The figure in the middle who is gesturing towards the Englishman is Asaf himself. And the person to whom he is gesturing, the tall Englishman on the left-hand side, is Colonel Mordaunt. And Colonel Mordaunt was an adventurer of the best possible kind. He was illegitimate, he was illiterate, but he was great at giving parties. And this is one of the reasons that Usuf took him on. And here's Mordaunt organising a cockfight, a favourite pastime of the Nawabs, and quite clearly of the Europeans too. And after Mordaunt's death, shortly before that of the Nawab, it is said that Usuf Adola never smiled again. Though he was completely entranced by Colonel Mordaunt, who was putting on all these entertainments for him. We've also got a number of other interesting figures. The tall man standing up at the end in a red jacket is Gabriel Harper, who was briefly resident for a couple of years. To the extreme right and facing the audience, if you like, or the viewer, is the artist himself, Sophony. And going down from him towards the centre, you'll see a man in a red jacket with one knee crossed over the other. And this is Major General Claude Martin, who played a highly influential role in the early history of Lucknow, and to some extent still does today. So it's a wonderful picture. It is filled with interest. Interestingly enough, it's possible, we think, that the artist actually painted this when he returned to England. He certainly sketched all the figures, but none of them were all together at the same time, and therefore we're assuming it was done on his return. It is a wonderful painting. And if you bear in mind the image of the cocks fighting down there, this is an early 18th century cockpit that was discovered in Lucknow. It's called Kokori Koti because its present owners came from the village of Kokori. And it is an amazing discovery. It is within a private house, and we're pretty sure that this has a connection with Claude Martin. There's no doubt about that. We believe that Martin built it for the Nawab who loves cockfighting. Martin always looking to turn a quick rupee. He says, I'll build you a wonderful cockpit. And he did. The colours are original. Some of the glass is still left at the top. That is original too. Certainly the fireplace is original. And I just hope it is preserved. American academics have now started to get wind of this. I don't tell them where it is. I can be very possessive about Lucknow buildings. But this is wonderful. And this again is a very well-known painting. It's in the Victoria Memorial in Calcutta. And unfortunately, we can't see it very well because it's actually at an angle. But the reason it's interesting is that it shows Claude Martin again standing up on the right-hand side. He is pointing towards a building that he's just constructed, which still survives. It's now known as the Fahad Baksh. And it is being held up, the watercolour is being held up by one of his servants. It's either Chota or Machu Kadir, one of the Persian servants who acted as stewards. And Martin's arm is behind that of John Womwell, who was the company accountant, an extraordinary, avaricious man. And he had been sent by the company to try and sort out the Nawab's financial affairs. And one of the reasons why the post of treasurer and accountant was so important that the English perceived that Usuf Adola, being a spendthrift, was not actually paying the debts owed towards the company. So what they did, and it wasn't just in Lucknow that they did this, they went through his household accounts in minute detail and said, you have to cut, it's rather like talking to an accountant, you have to cut this, you have to cut that, you have to cut something else. And from this, we actually have an idea of the huge courtiers and the household that Usuf Adola presided over. There was something ridiculous like 63 barbers and there were other people to actually pick your ears, and there were painters, and of course there was the stable, and there was the food where dishes would be prepared day and night, and very, very little of it eaten. So John Womwell is an important man who actually came back to Britain and was able to buy a very, very large estate in the north of England from his proceeds. there is a term, Nawabs, which is ironical, describing many of the East India Company officials who, if they made it back to England, brought with them Indian habits, but certainly brought with them, in nearly every case, a huge amount of money, and they were able to buy estates in England. So it's, as I say, an ironic term, the Nawabs, living like the Nawabs. In the middle of this painting, we have Johann Sofri again facing the audience, and to his left is Antoine-Louis Poirier, who was a French-Swiss adventurer, there's no doubt about it. Like Martin, he came out to fight in the French East India Company's army, the Compagnie des Indes. And both men decided that their future actually lay with the army of the East India Company, the English East India Company, who ultimately were more successful. The sad thing is that Poirier decided, having made his fortune, to return to France. And he'd been very much imbued with ideas of the Enlightenment and overturning old established views, and he was very anti-monarchy, and he made his views very, very clear. This was just after the French Revolution. He was actually done to death. He was murdered by a group of pro-royalist supporters. So I'm afraid his enormous fortune didn't do him very much good. But luckily, majority of manuscripts, and you see on the table behind him, there are some very fine Mughal manuscripts, were saved, and most of them are now in the Berlin Museum. So it is a moment captured in time. Claude Martin and his building, Poirier and his manuscripts, and this all takes place in Lucknow. And one interesting detail that I only realized a few years ago, and it just shows, you know, how often you have to look at pictures like this. You see the angle of the table is jutting out in front of Martin's legs. It's a right angle. And in his hand, he's holding a pair of compasses. And this, of course, is the sign of the Freemasons. And it's a little visual pun, if you like, what we call a rebus, on Freemasonry. And this is actually what enabled men like Martin to rise up through the hierarchy, because the majority of English officers at the time were Freemasons, and this is a kind of brotherhood. So despite all the inhibitions of class that the British suffered from and still do, it meant that if you were a Mason, you had a kind of fraternity. Martin himself, as he built his last house, said that he wanted to turn it into a lodge, and he actually writes to Poirier and say, can you send me some jewels and books of the Masons? Like many of the Europeans, both Poirier and Martin took Indian wives, or Bibis as they were known. There doesn't seem to have been much of a marriage ceremony here, but this is a particularly fine painting. It's again by Sofri, and it shows Martin's favorite wife, and she was called the Gori Bibi because of her very fair complexion. She is believed to have come from Persian family. Martin had seven mistresses. She was the favorite. He admits very frankly in his will that he took a lot of young women to bed. And what's interesting is, though Martin himself was very much a figure of the Enlightenment and rationality, he talks to God in his will as though he's trying to explain some of his actions. It's like a kind of balance sheet, and Martin leaves a lot of money to the poor, and he's hoping that that's actually going to pay off. It's a trade-off for taking all these young women to bed. So that's the Gori Bibi, and her tomb is actually very near that of Paul Martin's in Lucknow at La Martinière School. And the little boy who's looking up at the Gori Bibi is James Zulfikar, and he was adopted by the Gori Bibi, not adopted by Claude Martin. This has led to some confusion that people believe that Martin had heirs of his own. In fact, he didn't. He was impotent. John Womwell is sitting here, and you'll notice that he is very much adopted Indian dress and Indian habits too. He's sitting on the terrace on the banks of the Gumti. He's smoking a hookah, and he's wearing a turban, which is quite imitative of those of the Nawabs, and his rather bored servant behind. No fly was going, his shoulders, you know, sort of flapping ineffectually at this plump Englishman. But what I want to show is how the early Europeans, the 18th century Europeans, very much assimilated into Indian society. They wore Indian dress. Claude Martin appears to be the only one who didn't. And I think this is because he felt rather like an outsider, being a Frenchman from a working class family, but people like Wombwell had no inhibitions at all. And what is interesting, this is Antoine Louis Pollier again, and you can see that not only has he adopted Indian dress, and he has his hookah, he's also started to grow moustaches, rather like Shujah Dowla and Asaf Dowla, those long, droopy moustaches, which were actually a fashion among the Persians at that particular time. So he could hardly appear more Indian. He was extremely fond of dance and musical notation, and it's believed that the dancers are actually explaining to him here what they're doing, and you see the drummers behind him. So again, someone who has totally absorbed themselves into Indian culture. And because they had a foot in both camps, if you like, both employed by the East India Company, Pollier as a geographer and Martin as an armourer, yet they still managed to work with the Nawabs and with the Nawabi nobles and to make their fortune privately. It was certainly not the wages they received from the East India Company that made them both such very, very rich men. Saadat Ali Khan had been involved in the supposed murder of one of his brother's favourites way back in the mid-1770s, and as a result, he was exiled. He spent quite a number of years in Varanasi, but he also spent more time in Calcutta. And this, I am convinced, is where he got the idea for many of his buildings from. This is St. John's Church, which was finished about 1784. Warren Hastings donated quite a large sum of money towards it. But you can see now the European classical style very, very strongly pronounced there. And this is what Saadat Ali Khan brought back to Lucknow with him when he was made the Nawab in 1801. And so what happens if you've spent the formative years of your life in Calcutta, in what is clearly a European city, what do you do when you get back to Lucknow? You hire an English architect, you try to recreate what you have seen, and there's no doubt this is where the inspiration for many of Lucknow's European buildings, as I call them, came from. This is the Dil Kusha. Parts of it remain. It's to the south of Lucknow, and it was set in Hunting Park. And it is based very, very closely on a building at Seton Delaville in Northumberland, which was designed by Sir John Vanbrugh. And it seems to me quite likely that Saadat Ali Khan, who was perhaps one of the most intelligent and cultured clubs, had a look at Papal Book. It was printed in Vitruvius Britannica, and said, oh, that looks nice, I'll have one of those. And so he got Sir Gore Ousby to build him one. The main block is in the centre with the triangular roof. To one side is the kitchen block, and to the other side is the stable block. And it's perhaps ironic that the only part now remaining in any kind of repair is the stable block. But just have a look at what happened to it later on, bearing this in mind. That's what happened, and you can see it's actually lost its triangular roof, but it has grown extraordinary little pediments and turrets and roofs which are made out of green glazed tiles. And it never actually worked as a palace, if you like, or a country house, because it had no separate place, it had no separate zanana for the women. So it was left to decay, only used occasionally. People would go down and take a picnic there.
and that was it. I talked earlier about Major General Paul Martin, and again, his fantastic building in La Martinez, huge architectural influence on Nawabs and much subsequent building. And you can see many of the features here which were repeated right up until the 1850s. Martin became such an influential man that he couldn't really be removed by the museum. In the end, decided to tolerate him and conveyed the title of Major General to him. So that's La Martinière, still recognisable in Lucknow today. And this is the building that Martin wanted to be a Freemason's lodge. It's around the Union Jack because it was used as a place where the incoming British president would stay for a few days before moving on to the residency. Is that better?
There we are, we're back in business. Okay, so this is the British residency in Lucknow, and it is a very, very plain Palladian building, if you will. And gradually, the resident assumed so much power that not only did he have his own house, he has his own stables, he sets up a banqueting hall. There are areas for the soldiers, the sepoys. There are pleasure gardens, and perhaps one of the most important things is the treasury, because if you're collecting vast amounts of money from the land revenue and from the Nawabs themselves, you obviously need somewhere very secure to put it. So what had started off as a fairly ad hoc arrangement of the British resident to the Nawabs court develops into a huge panoply of British officials who are all backed up by their Indian clerks. And in fact, the residency in Lucknow occupied a very, very large area, about 33 acres. And the residents themselves began to hold durbars in imitation of the Nawabs. So it was very much the two courts. And what is interesting is that Indians who had houses around the periphery of the residency imagined that they had some kind of protection from the British resident simply because their houses were near to this enormous complex. And you can see how it changed and developed and was adapted for the Indian climate. If you look at that, there's no defense against the sun. The sun is going to come straight in. You have no verandas. And it was very quickly found that you have to adapt to the Indian climate, as in fact a lot of English did. And it wasn't just to the climate that they adapted. So here it has grown verandas. It has a signal tower there. And it remained a huge area of influence. We have many, many descriptions of it because every European who visited Lucknow went straight to the residency where they were in their little enclave. And interestingly enough, it was only in the residency area that the roads were actually paved, and people commented on that, contrasting it to the awful state of the roads outside, particularly in the choke. Sadat Ali Khan had set up the main street called Hasrat Ganj, which is like a processional way, and it went from Dilkusha, the building I showed you earlier, right up to the
residency. So that was an improvement. But as I say, people continued to snipe and to comment on the filthiness of the old city. And that actually ties up with a lot more criticism. It's not just the filthiness of the city. You then start to criticize the characters of the men who live there and rule there. It is all bound up together. This splendid figure is the Nawab Ghazi-ed-Din Haider, and the British trying to wean him away from his residual affection, if you like, for the Mughal emperor, dangled the idea of becoming a king in front of him. They said, how would you like to be king? We will make you king. And in fact, they dangled this promise in front of several other rulers too, including the Nizam of Hyderabad. But it was only Ghazi-ed-Din Haider who was perhaps greedy enough to snatch very eagerly at the idea of becoming a king. So he has a crown which is designed by his English court artist, Robert Hume. He has an ermine robe, and every time I look at this, I think, God, it must have been really, really hot wearing it's fur. I mean, it's a fur cape. I mean, who was mad enough to wear a fur cape in India? But all of these luscious robes were designed by Hume, and they're actually made up by Eden Ravenscroft, designers to the court back in London, who still to this day supply university robes for graduates at the graduation ceremony at the mortar court. So its provenance is impeccable. And of course people jibed and said, well, all right, I mean, he's really only exchanged one master, the defunct Mughal emperor, for another one, a much more dangerous one, the company. And this is Nasruddin Haider. He is also wearing the same ermine robe. This is by an Indian artist, we don't know who, but again he's got this very, very splendid crown and the osprey feathers, and apparently it depends on the kind of feathers you have in your crown how high your status is. I learned this recently from a friend of mine who's the Persian curator at the British Library. So depending on the feathers, you could tell how high up the hierarchy people were. Nasruddin Haider is perhaps, I think it's fair to say, he was always regarded as the playboy of the Nawabi dynasty, and I think probably Indians themselves would admit that. And he was of course heavily criticised by the British, who always sniped away, but I think in this case they probably had reason to. So Nasruddin Haider, and you notice that he has a very fine head of curly hair, and this is the reason why. This is the infamous barber of Lucknow, George Harris de Roussat, who came to Calcutta, changed his name from Quickly, his original family name, which was an Irish name, and he thought that a French name would suit him rather better, as many hairdressers do even today. So he becomes de Roussat. And he undertakes to curl Nasruddin Haider's hair. Nasruddin Haider had very, very straight hair, and de Roussat somehow managed to curl it up. So this is why you always see Nasruddin Haider with wonderful curls, a sort of perm, if you like, an early perm. The barber became an absolutely infamous character, and one of the reasons was that, like Claude Martin, he came from a working class background, and the snobbishness of the East India Company meant that he was always persona non grata. And he also inveigled himself into court life very successfully. So within a few years, he was not only looking after the king's wardrobe, his toshakhana, but he was actually fitting out a boat for him called the Sultan of Oud. And he was involved in all kinds of things. He had a finger in every pie. And it was his story that actually influenced the annexation of 1856, because this book by William Knighton was published in 1856, The Private Life of an Eastern King, and it is the story of the barber of Lucknow and his English mates who actually inveigled themselves into the court of Nasruddin Haider. Now, it's interesting that there is a gap of about 20 years between the events that actually happened, which were related to William Knighton, who himself was actually no mean scribe. He was a respectable man teaching at the university in Calcutta. But Knighton knows a good story when he hears one. So he sits down and he listens to all of Cropley, the librarian's stories about the wicked Barber of Lucknow. And when it is published, it causes a sensation. It is republished three times within 1 month because people in Britain who are quite keen on the idea of annexation say, look, you know, you've got to annex it. It's such a corrupt state. This is going on, that is going on. And they actually haven't made the distinction between the last Nawabawal king, Wajid Ali Shah, and what had happened 20 years earlier. It didn't actually matter to him. This was a scandalous book. It did extremely well. And it was based on the goings-on of Durrusat, the Barber of Lucknow. And we're lucky that we actually have quite substantial records now of what the Barber was able to keep and the money he made. And unfortunately, he lost most of it in railway shares when he returned to Britain. This is a picture from Knighton's book, and it shows the king, Nasruddin Haider, curly hair, wearing European dress, of which he was very fond indeed, and he's having a little cockfight session on the table. And you notice he's grasping a decanter of wine, and a wine glass has been overturned. So general debauchery all round. And you can imagine how highly he was criticised by the British residents, who are always writing back to Calcutta saying, this cannot go on any longer. Wajid Ali Shah, the last king in India, very, very handsome portrait of someone who, like his great-great-uncle, Asafoerdun, was always a very, very portly man. He was big, there's no doubt about it. And this is really what leads to the conclusion of the story, that it didn't really matter what the Nawabs did. They were bound to be criticised. So in the end, they said to themselves, it doesn't matter what we do. We can spend as much money as we like on our palaces and our entertainers, because real power had been stripped from them. They had no political power. They had very little power by 1856 within their own country. So all they could do was to amuse themselves by building lavish palaces and entertainments. Wajid Ali Shah was particularly fond of animals, and he set up a large menagerie. Here he is being greeted by Lord Harding, the Governor General, and this is right at the beginning of his reign in 1847. And Harding comes along and he reads out a 12-page document telling Wajid Ali Shah that if he doesn't mend his ways, alter his behaviour, then the British are going to come in and annex his state. And the only reason it didn't happen sooner was that Harding then got involved in the Anglo-Burmese wars and he got distracted. But here he is hugging Wajid Ali Shah. This, we think, probably took place at one of the palaces along the banks of the Gumti. One of the reasons that the English were very, very happy to criticise Wajid Ali Shah was his enormous number of wives. He was supposed to have had about 370, so that's actually more than one per day for each day of the year. He didn't have them all at once, I have to add. can you imagine? And this comes from his autobiography called The Ishq Nama, which is in Windsor Castle. And the young lady who he is about to approach is called Safras Mahal. And she was a favourite for many, many years. And then he left her, he ditched her. And when, years later, she says, you know, I've fallen on hard times, can I have a small pension? He reacts in a really spiteful way. And he says, no, she was just a poor woman. She was a tailor. I picked her up from the gutter, more or less. She was already married. I took her from her husband. He doesn't realise what a bad light this paints him in.
So here he is, and you know, this is one of many of his amorous adventures. And this is an absolutely typical description. So there you are, poor man. He literally didn't have a chance. At the same time, he was an extraordinary commissioner of buildings. He was a very, very religious man, and when they're talking about debaucheries, he didn't drink. He never took alcohol. I have this from his descendants in Calcutta, and I have no reason to disbelieve them. So Dalhousie said, I'm going to annex Ubud. And Dalhousie actually wanted to do it as a parting coup, because he was due to go back to England and another governor general appointed. He wanted to do it as a parting gesture. He actually says that. He says, I would like to annex Ubud as a parting coup. And this is Wajid Ali Shah's nemesis, William Sleeman, who is probably better known for his suppression of thuggee and dacoits in the 1830s. But he is appointed as the British resident, and this is the last appointment of his career. And he wanted to retire, but he was persuaded to take up the thankless task of being British resident in Ubud. And he made a journey through the rural areas of Ubud. It's called Recollections of a Journey or something like that, which wasn't actually published until after annexation. But copies of it were circulating, and it painted the most dismal picture. How bad things were in the countryside, how much the city of Lucknow was a kind of precious bubble, if you like. And Sleeman was quite gullible for someone who actually spoke Persian and Hindi and had been in India for most of his working career. He was fairly gullible. So people would feed him stories about, you know, something the Nawab was supposed to have got up to. And he would take it all as gospel. He didn't actually bother to find out whether it's true. He barely communicated with the Nawab. So he writes a damning report, and that actually decides Dalhousie to annex the kingdom. And when I talk about a fatal friendship, it was fatal, obviously, to the Nawabi dynasty. This is the British residency after the siege of Lucknow, which lasted for 4.5 months. And you can see that it's very unlike the proud building which was established there at first. I'm not going to go into the siege because there's been so many written descriptions, but I think from this picture, we can see how devastating it was. And this, of course, reinforced the British opinion that, you know, someone who was prepared to besiege Britain's there. Though by this time, Wajid Ali Shah had actually left for Calcutta. He said he was going to meet Queen Victoria to try and get his kingdom back, but he didn't. That's another story. This is a painting which probably gives a better idea of the devastation of the Lucknow residency and all the buildings around it. And this was painted by Egon Lundgren, a Swedish artist who was sent out by Queen Victoria to record some of the devastating events of 1857, 1858. And here is an imaginative painting by William Simpson, who wasn't actually on the scene, but it's showing the British soldiers and some Sikh soldiers looting the Kaisabad Palace, that very handsome palace built by Wajid Ali Shah. And there's something so spiteful about this. They said, it is the palace of our enemy, though he had long fled. And looting went on for 3 days. It was really uncontrolled. There's a very, very, very vivid description by W.H. Russell, the correspondent of the Times, who saw it firsthand. And he said he saw men staggering out of the palace. They were drunk with plunder. It's such a descriptive phrase. So this, unfortunately, is why we don't have an awful lot of Nawabi records left, because a lot of them were looted and destroyed. The Ishqnama that I showed you earlier was looted from this palace, and it was presented to Sir John Lawrence, who in turn presented it to Queen Victoria, which is why it's at Windsor Castle today. And I think I have to finish on
this note, which is not actually about the city of Lucknow, but it seems to me so apposite, so descriptive of the demise of that fine city, of indeed the fatal friendship of the British towards Lucknow. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen.
Request Professor Azim to join our guest on stage and commence the question answer session, which will be for 15 to 20 minutes.
After this very glossy and wonderfully presented presentation lecture, I open the floor for questions, and I would like to keep your questions brief.
Introduce yourself and just ask the question or comment or anything to add. We're not going to be able to go long with the question answer, so we try to keep it within 15 to 20 minutes. So let's start with questions. And thank you for a wonderful lecture. We were spent.
The gate that you showed last, the last slide, that's probably the gate to the Machi Bhavan, is it?
I'm sorry, what was your question?
The gate that you showed the last slide, was it the gate to the Machi Bhavan?
It was the Kaiser Bagh Palace.
The Kaiser Bagh.
I'm sorry, I should have made that clear. Yeah.
Mm. I was wondering why this recurrent motif of the fish in Lucknow.
That's because In 1722, an award was made by the Mughal emperor to the Nawabs, and it was the Maha Maratib, which is a fairly well-known award. You can see pictures of it in the Parshanama, and it has two fish suspended from a pole. And it seems to me quite clear that despite, you know, fanciful stories of fish jumping into the Nawab's boat as he's crossing the Gomti, the Nawabs were so pleased with this that they introduced it as their motif, and hence you get the Machi Bhavan, the fish house. And by the end of the Nawabs' reign, the fish have transferred themselves into something quite grotesque, and you get all these enormous mermaids, which are perhaps a kind of fish. They've got fishy tails, but they are completely over the top by the 1850s, and they're also painted in brilliant colours, and this is another thing that, you know, people made fun of, but you can actually see how it developed from a fairly chaste fish into something amazing, a mermaid with a tail.
Thank you, that was fascinating. I have two questions. One is very simple. The last two lines that you showed, where are they from?
No, it I don't think it's Gulliv, I think it's Mir. It is Gulliv, is it? I'm sorry, I should have checked. I was just so struck with it. I thought, okay. I've got to have this. No, I have a feeling it's by Mir.
Okay.
Yes.
I think in your book it's shown as Mir, probably.
Yes.
And the second question, which of course keeps bothering me, is what gave the East India Company so much power? I mean, they weren't the rulers of India. They were just a corporation. What gave them so much power that they could, go into the Nawab's accounts and ask them to account for everything that they did and threaten them with punishment if they did not behave?
Well, it really started after the Battle of Plassey, when the Nawab of Bengal was defeated, and shortly after that was the Battle of Buxar. So you're looking at military defeats where the company are actually winning battles on the ground, and Robert Clive gets the Diwani, he gets the rights to the land revenue of Bengal, Bihar and Orissa, and gradually the companies start seeping up northern India, and their armies are also increasing. What they're doing are hiring out their own soldiers, the sepoys, to Indian rulers who want to play one off against the other. But their power in Awadh really came from the Battle of Buxar, where they defeated Shuja-ud-Dowlah and Mir Qasim and the Emperor. And they were able to say, as I explained earlier, it was like a protection racket. They said, you will never be threatened again by outside forces. And we've got to remember how uncomfortable and dangerous the 18th century was, because you've got the Rohillas coming along, and then you've got the Marathas, and you've got the Jats, and you've got everyone. It was a highly troubled period. So the British said, look, don't worry, our troops will look after you. Station them in the cantonments around Lucknow. You pay for them. And you also actually owe us quite a lot of money, because we spent a lot of money defeating you at Buxar. And this is how it worked. And, you know, the Nawab was prepared to go along with it. So this is, but it's also, it's not just military defeats and financial penalties. It is a kind of eagerness among the Nawabs to enjoy Western things. Asif Ad-Daulah with his, you know, mad wish for European toys. I would say that the Nawabs themselves contributed somewhat to their downfall. And if you start to have European buildings, you get a European to build a building in, you know, in your city, you're introducing another dimension. So it is the pro-Western proclivities of the Nawabs, I think, which actually contributed to their downfall. Had they remained staunch and unblinking, you know, they're not going to have anything European at all, I think things might have been different.
At one point of your presentation, you mentioned about Asif-ud-Dowlah's practice. Question is to what? Do you find this practice of diverse sexuality prevalent among other Nawabs of Lucknow? Thank you.
Yes. I can't comment on how current it might have been. We have this information, obviously, from the British residents who were reporting on his proclivities, and we have hints from some Indian writers. I think the fact that you know, his supposed heir, Wazir Ali, was deposed shortly afterwards probably has something to do with it. We will never know, but we certainly have descriptions of him cavorting with young boys.
Professor, three very quick questions. Obviously, the Nawabs were very passionate about the arts, all the arts. How much actually did they also contribute to the language by which, Urdu, because Lucknow is known to be the birthplace of Urdu. Second, even if, instead of being lecherous, they had the metal, they had the character, they had the fiber of Tipu Sultan, would it have made any difference? And the third and the last question, these British sites that you mentioned, that the Nawabs purchased by looting from India, can they be identified? Because then, like Bangladesh, India, Pakistan, we can, like Shashi Tharoor, put again.
That's a very good question. Did the Nawabs contribute towards the Urdu language? And the answer is no, because everything happened at court in Persian. Wajid Ali Shah preferred to have all his correspondence in Persian. He himself was interested in regional languages. He composed things in Braj Bhasa. But no, I wouldn't say that they contributed that much. But there was an atmosphere where the poets would come, particularly from Delhi, after the capture of Delhi by the British in 1803. Lucknow attracted poets because obviously they were patrons there. And you could say it had developed there. And I think the fact that when I did my Urdu course so many years ago at SOAS, two of our set books, obviously Geschichte Lucknow, but the other one was Umra Janada, which is one of my favorites, and you can see then how it is starting to spread. Your other question was whether the Nawabs, had they been of firmer stuff, could have resisted the British, and yes, I think they absolutely could have done. And as I said, it was their fascination with European artifacts and with European men too. You know, the affection of Nasruddin Haider towards the Barber of Lucknow that was really their downfall. Once you start to let the enemy in, there's no going back.
Last question. Okay, my name is Rosie is very familiar to me. It's a long, long time that we have been together in London. But besides that, you know, I just have three very simple sort of things. You may throw some light on that. By the middle of the 19th century or early 19th century, how much of these people, the people from the Persian origin, were actually carrying out Persian culture in India at that time, by the beginning of the 19th century? How much they were Persianized at the time, or they have become really Indianized? The one thing. The second thing is that, you know, we have the same sort of name as Dilkusha, or Dilkush, Dhaka as well. You have also in Abu. What is actually referred to? I may not know, but what does it actually refer to? Dilkush for what? And finally, you may regret your all not about your about Nawab, etc. But I'm very happy in India, because Wajid Ali Shah, if he was not in India, then he would not have been the cultural, the Indian cultural trope. This is, he's the Indian cultural mentor. He's the great man of culture, man of music, and that kind of things. Had he been in out, probably this part of his personality would never have come out. That's why I'm not very unhappy that he was out and came to Canada.
Well, I'm not very happy about it either. let me see if I can remember your questions. Persian influence. It was starting to decline, there's no doubt about that. By the beginning of the 19th century, the Nawabs, as you know, had actually come from Naishapur in Persia, and they'd come there. It was Burhanul Mulk, the first Nawab, who actually moved his family from Naishapur. But interestingly enough, the family had 2 centuries earlier actually come from Iraq. They'd come from Najaf, which is why you start to get not only the Shia influence, but they're actually importing artisans from Iraq to put up some of their religious buildings in Lucknow. And I'm told that there's even today a very small colony of people whose ancestors were Iraqi. And you asked about the Dilkusha. It's a very familiar word. I know there's a Dilkusha here. It simply means heart's delight, heart's joy. So the Dilkusha Palace in Lucknow was somewhere where Sadat Ali Khan thought he could go and have a jolly time. But as I explained, because of the actual shape of the building, you cannot transpose a European building and plonk it down in the plains of India. It doesn't work, and you could see that quite clearly with the British residency, which had to be adapted. And yes, Wajid Ali Shah, a man of huge culture, there's absolutely no doubt about it, and I think we're just starting to realise how important he was. Since my biography of him was published, there have been 2 more fairly important research theses. One is looking at his musicians and how he employed musicians. Once he moved to Calcutta, the musicians who went to Garden Reach, and how he really promoted Hindustani music and how that influenced the music of Bengal. There's no doubt about that. And secondly, a number of his own manuscripts have come to light in the Persian department at the British Library, and he's got annotations in his own handwriting, and we're just now starting to look at those. So I think in a few years' time, hopefully, everybody else will be aware of, you know, this important man that I really do champion.
Anything that we'd like to add from our own?
You said about Asifuddin Dola that he was a large-hearted man, and there was a saying in the chowk of actually the bazaars of Faizabad and also in Lucknow, which went like this. Jisko naade mola, usiko de asifu dola. There was a battle with God. You know?
Yes.
No, I mean, nobody came empty-handed from his palace.
You're absolutely right. He was a large-hearted man. He was a large-hearted man too.
There are no more questions. I just wanted to add my own. And I think Rosie has answered or hinted at it. Wajid Ali's sojourn in Calcutta, or banishment to Calcutta, and the influence that it has had on Bengal, as it were, and the way that the cultures lives, a great deal of historical research and work needs to be done. Because also while we are exploring Bengali identity, Bengali culture, we can see many mixtures, many other influences that can be traced. So I think that banishment from Lucknow to Calcutta enriched Calcutta in ways. And it always reminds me of the film Shatranj Ki
Talab. Oh yes, that's an absolute favorite. Yes, it's true. I mean, the really sad thing is that on Wajid Ali Shah's death, all of his palaces at Garden Reach were sold off. There's only one that remains today. A lot of land was sold to railway companies. And the archives just vanished. I've never been able to find anything at all from Garden Reach. I've interviewed descendants. Some of them actually know less than I do about it. So it all vanished. A fairy tale kingdom just went.
I want to know that little line that's there in the and that manuscript must be there for the greater now.
Well, we don't know. As I said, I've never found anything at all, and I spent a very long time in Calcutta looking for stuff. But if somebody finds it, I'm more than happy. I really am. Thank you so much.
Thank you, everybody. Thank you for this wonderful. I would now request.
I'd like to make a comment, please.
Okay.
This is to address Kaiser someone. And also to bring the point about Dilkush. Actually, just outside of Dublin, I was in a hotel on the outskirts, or on the getting into Dublin city. I was in this hotel, and I came out of the hotel one morning, and there was this huge mansion with large gardens and a beautiful, white colonial type building, and it was called Dilkush. So I don't know. Maybe you know who was the owner of that, and if. And if Kaiser wants to make a list, he will start off with that one.
I don't know who the owner is or was, but I know that Dilkush was actually a very popular name, and I have seen houses in London called Dilkush. It's something that the British brought back with them, not at the time, but the British coming back after 47. It was just a nice word, a favourite word. So you will see houses called Dilkush.
I think thank you everybody for being such a wonderful audience, and thank you Rose, and thank you very much Wakart for organizing this. I was wondering whether you would like to say a few words about organizing, etc., because this would not have been possible if the Bangladesh Forum for Heritage Studies, and especially Wakart Khan, have not actually approached us and has helped us immensely in introducing us to Dr. Llewellyn-Jones as well as all this. Thank you. Thank you.
ask our Honorable Vice Chancellor, Professor Sayed Saad Dilip, to come and present a mark of our appreciation to the guest and give your vote of thanks.
Members of the audience, what a wonderful evening. I couldn't help but take notes today. 63 barbers, finely minced kebab, money transfers to the United Kingdom, Freemasons, corruption, debauchery, 370 wives, Persians, the Najafi people, the Brits, and the locals all in one area. No wonder it was an exciting place. So, all I can say is that this was a very fascinating evening. I'm not a historian, my background is engineering and business, but believe me, this was so fascinating. I just sat there, I could think of the early days when I used to hear these lovely stories from the ancient past here. So, we're really delighted that we were able to bring you here. I think we did engage in a conversation, and I really hope we'll be able to bring you back here many, many more times, because one visit is just not enough to delve deep down into you and find out and figure out the real essence of the connectivity, actually, of history to where we are today. In fact, you know, one of the deepest things, the issues that you brought up, the topics that you talked about, we see them even today. And therefore, I could see a connection there with the past. And I'm sure that there's some research that could guide us in terms of saying what was done in those days that have left their resonance that we can feel today, and maybe the seeds were sown at that time that led to where we are. So thank you again very much for being here. BRAC University is delighted to have you here, and we really want to welcome you back again and again. I would like to express again, like everyone else has done, the deepest thanks to Wakar Khan, a friend of mine. And when he approached me, I said, yes, we got to do this. And obviously, we have a wonderful staff here who've arranged all of this from the PR department. And not least of all, very, very gracious thanks to all of you, the audience, because it's you who make this evening possible. Thank you very much, all of you.
Just Walker, do you have add, this is a request to the dynamic Vice Chancellor of BRAC University. One of the reasons that I brought her to Dhaka is that history, the readings of history are slowly being eclipsed. That's one. And secondly, I would love people like Rosie to come now and then and sort of help us develop the history department and social sciences here. And she is, mind you, she's a member of a lot of the prestigious societies like the Royal Asiatic Society and all that. So you can seek her help in future. Because
absolutely, I don't think she just belongs to BRAC University. I think she belongs to all the universities, because we can of us learn from her. And I would really like to see all of us collaborate. I see North South University here, and I see Central Women's College here, I see Dhaka University. The Vice Chancellor herself, and on and on. I think this is a wonderful agglomeration of people who can really build this knowledge institutions here. And I think we must get together, pursue these collaborative endeavors, and have you over many, many more times. Thank you again. Thank you all. And let's give her one last round. Please join us for some refreshments. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, there's a book display outside, so I'm sure you've enjoyed the discussion here. You can browse at the books. The book of Fatal Friendship is also available outside.
Oh, yeah.